at a very personal level that seemed to hit you right where songs really should. And I guess it wasn't just me, because all over the world people were loving Eurythmics records. All 8 records went either gold or platinum. But it wasn't until she put out her first solo record, Diva, well, I think that's when she made her strongest artistic statement. So we're going to hear songs tonight from Diva and from Eurythmics, and you're lucky enough to be able to hear a couple of tunes from the brand new Annie Lennox record called Medusa that's coming out tomorrow. So here she is, Annie Lennox, live on Intermittent Interactive.
When there's got to be a whole heap of nothing for you and me. Take me to the desert, take me to the sand, show me the color of your hand.
Chill in my heart, yeah, you have a place to chill in my heart. You have a place to chill. Thank you. Yes. Well, I'd say we're off to a pretty spectacular start today. Thank you, Annie. It's wonderful to have you here. It's wonderful to have all of you here. We're going to have you all introduced a little while later. And we're going to introduce some of you a little while later, too. But I want to take this opportunity, because you did two songs there, one from Savage and one from Diva. So I want to sort of dive back into that little point of time in between Eurythmics and the first solo record. And just wondered, I mean, it obviously took a lot of courage to do a solo record, and whether or not the huge commercial success of Diva actually put aside any latent fears you might have had about being a solo person versus a duo.
Yeah, ironically, because I'm quite an anxious person, you know, I have a nervous tic, as you can see, and I'm trying to calm it down. But actually, surprisingly enough, I wasn't really too concerned about Diva, because for me, music making has always been something that was a central fabric of my life. So if it was a commercial success or not at the time wasn't important to me. What was important to me was that I was able to make great music, and with a little bit of help from Steve Lipson, who's drinking a double vodka bottle in the Stolly Snai over there, you know, since the experience, he's become a desperate alcoholic. You know, but I'm sorry, I had to announce that publicly on television tonight. Stephen, I thought you would like to stand up and tell the world about your alcohol problem. But it was all my fault, so I have to let him know.
There you go.
Okay.
Yeah.
So, it was wonderful that it was so successful. Of course it was. You know, it was a kind of affirmation that people liked me and liked the music and our work that we had done and we had loved and just grafted for. I mean, when you write songs, the thing is, there's nothing there, you know, it's just thin air and a head full of ideas or not, and a heart full of experiences, and looking to other wonderful songs that have inspired me as an artist, as a writer, I've always tried to have an element of that truth, of that artistic yearning. So I feel very, very fortunate, because we have a little team going here, and suffice to say, I think it's I'm very fortunate.
Yeah, and we're fortunate to have you. And I can tell there's some warmth happening in your team here, even if you do malign each other publicly. We're going to take some questions from faxes and emails, and I've got a lady over here who wants to ask a question. Hi.
Hi, Annie.
Hi.
I know that Joni Mitchell really inspired you. And I'm wondering who else did and who continues to inspire you today.
Well, Joni Mitchell, I was very poor for most of my life. I didn't have a record collection. And I happened to move into a flat in a very seedy part of Notting Hill Gate, where a rather sort of seedy person had a rather seedy record collection. I didn't have a drug problem at the time. Till I hired Joni Mitchell, and then, no. but I have to say that Joni Mitchell, you see, there have been very few women that have been singer-songwriters, and I didn't even know that that kind of animal existed until I heard her records and was very much identified with them, very inspired by them, suffice to say. And then I thought, well, this is something that I think I could do. So I kind of followed through, and there have been many great inspirations to me, and there still are, you know. The great people, they inspire me constantly.
Great, thanks. We've got a phone call right now. Darren from Moncton is on the phone. Hi, Darren.
Hi, Annie. Hi, Annie. Denise.
Hi.
Hi, Annie, I was wondering, what was your musical influences growing up?
Well, God, that's funny. You see, there's always been music in my family somehow. All my family sang. You see, the one thing that we've lost in this society, from my perspective, is that we've lost the ability to make music at home. And it was something that we used to do, all of us used to do that. And if you go to third world countries, you'll find that people are still doing that, because the market forces haven't sort of cottoned on to it yet, you know. So, you know, in Scotland we used to sing, and that was a tradition, and it doesn't exist anymore. And I would say probably that was the those were my influences. Just, you know, that I have a musical ear and I pick things up, and it would be anything from Noddy's Toy Town to, you know, tunes to anything I liked, you know, Scottish folk songs or what have you. And it was only later on when I became old enough to go to the dance hall, although my father would have been very happy for me not to go there, that I became exposed to things like Tamla Motown and soul music and the Temptations and the Supremes and all of those greats. I didn't even know who they were or what that music was, but I just loved it, and realized later that the influence had somehow sunk into my brain and into my heart.
And you're still carrying it with you. It's a spiritual thing, though, for you.
It's heavy, guys, it's heavy.
It's very heavy. Well,
oh, it's my load, and I'm gonna carry it, yeah.
I'm going to nip past you right here and walk over to this computer, because we've got people who've been emailing us for weeks trying to send a question your way. And Corinne here's got a question from?
From Gerald Morgan in Vancouver. Mm-hmm. And he writes, quite the outfit you had on at the Grammys. Where can I get my girlfriend one?
What was your name? Kevin, was it Kevin?
Gerald.
Carol.
Gerald.
Well, you can't, yeah, right, well, you can't. It's an exclusive line, exclusive to me, actually. And any girl worth her salt will not have her boyfriend buy that kind of outfit for her.
There you go, so take some good romantic advice there, Gerald. We've had phones, faxes, people in the audience. I want to let everybody know how you can get in touch with Annie. We're going to have lots more performance. Take a look at this. Write down the number.
If you would like to get intimate and interactive with Annie Lennox for questions and comments, the toll-free number to call is 1-800-265-MUCH. That's 1-800-265-6824. By fax, the number to call is area code 416-591-MUCH. That's area code 416-591-6824. And you can also email your questions to Annie at muchmusic.com.
Feeling intimate yet? One of the things you can do is go into one of the speakers' corners that we have across the country, and we've got a speakers' corner coming to us from where?
Toronto.
Here we go.
Go.
Hi, Annie. I always wondered, what was it that inspired you to write the song Cold?
I've often wondered that myself, actually. Well, you know, it's kind of fairly self-explanatory. It's a song about unrequited love and, you know, girlfriend. Hey, we've all had a few of those, you know what I mean. I'm not going to tell you the particular boyfriend at the time, if that's what you're getting at.
We've got another question from the audience. Sorry, hi, who are you?
Hi, my name's Cameron. Hi, welcome to Canada.
You're a florist, I see, right?
I'm not a florist, but I brought these for you.
Thank you. That's beautiful.
Can I?
Do you have a question?
I do have a question.
Yeah. Oh. We have a medic team outside. They'll be with you in just a second.
My question is actually, Annie, about your changing image over the years, whether we go back to the redheaded Sweet Dreams or Earl at the 83 Grammys, the blonde whore in I Need a Man, to Minnie Mouse at the Grammys.
Yeah.
What do you see as your most successful image, and what do you see as your next image?
I think the thing, if you want to talk about it in terms of success, the thing for me is that I still have the possibility to do what I want to do. That was always the point. I always felt that women, in particular, performers, are so classified and they're eaten up and spat out in such a kind of predictable sexual way. I mean, there's no problem with that if you want to be very sort of, you know, rifty-tifty, you know. But for me, that was never going to be the way. And in some way, I wanted to represent myself, to find my own true nature. And I change, we all change, everybody changes, you know, you change your hairstyle, da da da. I just do it publicly sometimes, that's all, you know, it's no big deal.
Well, we're going to go to another performance now. I'm trying to remember the outfit in Cold. It was a black and white hat thing. Beautiful. Large brim hat in the rain. Thank you very much for the honors.
I forgot you. So many.
There you go. This is another song. It's called Cold from Diva.
Thank you.
Thank you. Lovely. So nice. So nice. It's amazing watching you perform, you know, because I know you're a shy Scottish girl deep down in heart, but you abandon yourself to the performance. Where do you think that comes from?
That could be a trite question, you know. I mean,
could be,
you know,
yeah,
could be a trite answer coming from me as well. Well, you know, I discovered this thing, you know. I found the singing, man! You know. No, I mean, you know, it's this is what music is about, so what can I tell you, you know?
We're glad you found it. We're going to a commercial. We'll be right back after this with more Annie Lennox.
Intimate and Interactive is brought to you by Toyota.
Live, Intimate and Interactive with Annie Lennox, and we're going to take some more phone calls, some more faxes, chat with people in the audience, hear some more performances. And we've got a question here. You're from Spain, I understand.
Right.
What's
your question? My question is, why did you call your last album Medusa? What's the reason of it?
Well, the name just came to mind, and I liked it, you know. I mean, normally when we made records with Eurythmics and when I made Diva, at the end of the whole thing, there was a title that emerged from the songs. In this instance, this was this name, and it just stuck around, and I liked it. I liked all the implications of it, you know. I guess you know what that Medusa means in your language.
What does it mean in your language?
Well, is it called the same name, and you know, is the name of the Greek goddess with the snakes as hair?
Yeah, but also the jellyfish. Don't forget that bit. Okay. Right.
Also, the two sides of it. So the goddess and the jellyfish.
The goddess, jellyfish. I thought it was a nice name, you know.
There you go. We're going to hear a song from Medusa in just a minute. But first, we've got a phone call from Corey from Richmond Hill. Hi, Corey.
Hi, how you doing?
Excellent, thanks. You've got a question for Annie?
Yeah, actually, first off, Annie, I wanted to congratulate you on all your fame and success over the years.
Oh, thank you.
And I just want to ask you, like, being such an extremely artistic person, has music...
Artistic person, yes, it's true.
Has music always been your number one true love for a career, or was there another career choice that you would have liked to have pursued?
Well, originally I was going to be a classical flute player.
Yeah. Really?
Yeah, you know, can you see me playing classical flute, you know? Jane Galway? You know, but no, when I found my, you know, when I found my niche, I stuck to it, you know, and I was very lucky to meet Dave Stewart because the two of us, you know, we were a strong partnership, and that was amazing. We were really great with each other for a long time, you know. So, does that answer your question?
Oh, yeah.
Okay.
Thank you very much. It's interesting because when people talk about the partnership, it's the most successful male-female duo of all time, apparently. So
I thought that was Ike and Tina.
This is what I read in a bio someplace.
Well, maybe somebody lay claims to it, you know, and I'm not saying that.
Well, it's an interesting thing because I know there's a dance that happens with songwriters, and sometimes you can get a very potent result when you have two musical inputs. So is it a more true result when it's only you, do you think, or just what's the difference?
No, I don't think it's necessarily. I mean, I think it's a true result when both people are enjoying what they're doing and they're feeding off each other and they have that, you know, sort of symbiotic relationship, you know, creatively. It's fantastic. I think it starts to get stilted if it stops being not just fun, but it stops being a kind of discovery, exploration. That's the point when you lose it, you know, and that's the point to recognize you have to move on and do other things. It's nothing to do with ego or anything like that. It's just to do with being true to yourself, and it applies to everything. It's not just music making. It just applies to baking, you know, artistic crafts.
You're gonna do a song from Medusa, which is a song or a record that you used to sort of break the pattern for yourself, doing an album of cover material. And there's an interesting choice, actually, No More I Love You's, because it seems to discuss sort of a recurring theme, this inability of humans to communicate that you keep returning to.
I do that. I see that around me all the time, so I guess I have to get it out somehow.
Well, let's get it out musically.
Okay, let's get it out.
Okay, here we are. No More I Love You's, Annie Lennox.
Oh, changes are shifting outside the womb. I used to have demons in my room at night. Desire, despair, desire.
It's wonderful. It's really, on that song in particular, but there's a lot of layering of vocalizations. You really, really use your voice so much as an instrument in recording.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yes, I do, yes. Yeah,
yeah, because it has a, it has a more human quality at some level, is that it? Yeah. We're going to go to a speaker's corner question right now. Have a look at the monitor, and I have no idea where this body is coming from, but here it is. And it's gonna roll.
Listen carefully.
Hi, my name is Lori, and I'm in Banff, Alberta. And I have a question for Annie Lennox. I want to know how she balances being a mom with her career, because she sure seems to do it well. And I saw her new video, and it is hot. Thanks.
There you go, the eternal balancing act.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, every working mother knows that, you know. I mean, we have our lot now. We have our freedoms. Oh, some of us, I would take that back. Some of us have our freedoms. The problem is, you know, to juggle this thing. If you want to maintain a separate identity from being a hands-on mother, which I think is a splendid thing to do. I try to do the best I can, and I adore my children. What can I tell you? You know, I like any other human being does.
It's funny because when you get past the guilt of not being there, you got to realize that they have to respect that you're doing what you want to do, and the happier person and the quality times. Motherhood, we could talk about it forever. Mm-hmm. Okay. We're going to take a commercial break and come right back with more from Annie Lennox.
It's brought to you by Toyota. The Challenge.
Live, intimate and interactive with Annie Lennox. Here's a song. It's called Here Comes the Rain Again. It's live.
Here comes the rain.
Annie, I've got a question for you that just came over on the fax. It's from Catherine from Markham, Ontario. And she says, I've had this question for you sitting around in my brain for a long time now, and I'd really appreciate it if you give me some feedback. Do you think that female artists, especially musicians, danger themselves and their reputation by giving away too much?
I don't understand the question. Is that costume-wise or, you know?
I think in terms of songwriting, maybe revealing, or where do you draw the line between public, private, that kind of thing?
I think people tend to think that their whole lives should be, you know, in the living room nowadays. And that worries me, you know, people in my position, you know, they tend to think that there is no boundary anymore. Mm. And I personally think there has to be a boundary because, you know, you are you and you have a life and you are a person. And sometimes being a famous person, I feel occasionally quite marginalized. I mean, I did that, I put myself there, you know, but at the basis of it all, I'm kind of person, you know. Mm. And I think if you get taken up in your own mythology, then it's very, very dangerous psychological ground. So, I mean, I think that this is not an easy place to be, and I think it is like a calling. I think you really have to know that you are there for a purpose. And I think if you are there for monetary gain solely, or fame, or, you know, whatever these kind of red herrings are, mm-hmm. it's completely the wrong purpose, and it'll take you to a very bad place, you know. That's my own feeling about it.
Yeah, we've seen all kinds of examples of that, especially in the pop world, too. People just can't handle that kind of thing.
And, you know, women have no protection, and historically we've always been taken advantage of, and we tend to think that we mustn't think for ourselves, you know. And it's only recently that people have started to come up, women, and, you know, to take handle on things. But I'm still kind of surprised at just how much gain people get out of a bit of exposure of the flesh. But I don't think in the long run that that's a healthy thing for any individual, you know.
No, true enough. You lose your ground no matter what, sooner or later.
Yeah, it's hard enough, you know, it's hard enough just being anybody, just getting by. It's hard enough, you know.
Mm. We've got a caller, I think, Noah. Noah, you're calling from Kingston? Hi.
Hi. My question to you, Annie, is when after Eurythmics did you decide to release the first solo album?
I never really decided that. That was something that sort of came along, you know. I had no plans. When Dave and I sort of went in our separate directions, I just thought, I want to have a baby. That was what I thought, you know. Yeah. That was actually my intention. And I didn't have any kind of career plans at all. There came a time when I recognized that music was very, very important to me. And I had sort of taken it for granted, you know, because I've been on tour for years and years and years. And I kind of had been in hotel rooms and in airports and in airplanes. And it was starting to get, like, it was easing my life. I didn't have a life, you know. So I was very relieved to get out of that. But, you know, then you know, the music came back, and I'm very fortunate that I just have, like I said earlier, I have a very lovely team of people around me, small, you know, it's like home cooking, really. They're my friends as well. And here I am for my sins, you know.
Yeah, but you do love it when you actually get on that stage.
Yeah.
You can tell.
Yeah,
come on.
Kind of.
The question over here. Hi.
Hi there, Annie. Welcome to Toronto.
Hi. Thank you.
You have such an incredible presence. When you work, I would think that a chameleon such as yourself would have so many offers to do films and theater and stuff like that. Do you have any future plans in acting?
Well, people have asked me that question for years, you know. And I think the thing for me is that I'm so satisfied in this thing that I'm doing now, and the fact that I get to make videos is like a bonus for me, because it's the visual aspect of things always interested me, and I never thought that I would end up doing this, you know. I mean, there is no training scheme for this. You know, it's you make it your own way.
And you deserve an Oscar anyway.
Oh, well, hey, you know.
There you go. You're going to do a song from the new record. It's a Clash tune. What drew you to this song?
Well, actually, it was to do with the balancing of the pacing of the record. We were looking for a song that would be more up-tempo, because I always tend to go for these sort of rather melodramatic, melancholic, you know, demons of songs. And this was a notion, and it had been around for the whole time that we were recording Medusa. And the very last week, we went back to it and readdressed it out of a sense of desperation, because we didn't have that track, and we looked at many. We came to this Clash song, and we put a different groove to it, and it's found a gospel soul base now. And, well, anyway, you can, you know, here's the litmus test. You can see whether you hate it or love it or whatever.
Right, here's Train in Vain, Annie Lennox.
Thank you. things you can't explain away, but the heartache's with me till this day. Did you stand by me? No, not at all. Did you stand by me? No way. There were times when we were close. Without you around, so alone I keep the wolves at bay, and there's only one thing I can say. Just stand by me, oh, yeah, stand by me.
Rare moments, some intimate moments, some musical moments with Annie Lennox. We're going to be right back. More right after this.
Intimate and Interactive is brought to you by Toyota.
And Intimate and Interactive with Annie Lennox. And just before we get started again, I don't mind if you indulge me for a sec. I just want to introduce you to the members of the band here, because there's been some spectacular performances going on tonight. And we're going to start The man with the hat over here, Stephen Lipson, producer of both Diva and Medusa and Simple Minds and Trevor Horn, and a musician, a producer extraordinaire. He's wonderful. Some genuflecting going on there. We've got Andy Richards over there with his hair all slicked back and looking very groovy. He's on keyboards. He's worked with Rush, also a producer in his own right, sort of moonlighting right here. On other keyboards too, Andy's right, is Pete Levin. Give it up there for Pete. Behind me on guitars is Paul Pesco, with those fabulous arms in the back of all those shots. On drums, Steve Wolf, over there. On percussion, Carol Steele. Well done. And on backing vocals, starting from here, Stephanie James, Andrika Brown, and Marvel Allen, doing a superb job this evening. Thank you all. There you go. Now that we know everybody, we can continue on a little bit. We've got one more song coming up. I just want to take some more phone calls, a fax or two maybe. What would you like? An email question. There you go. Corinne, have we got someone on the email?
It's a very busy night tonight on the internet, Denise. We have a message here from someone who will only identify themselves as Chef Yeah Yeah Yeah. And he or she writes, as well as an amazing voice, your visual presentations have always enhanced and pulled me deeper into the music. Are your videos your own ideas or those of different directors?
Well, yeah, with Eurythmics, Dave and I collaborated, and essentially we weren't experienced enough always to know how to direct videos. Am I looking at you? Am I looking at And then, I feel like a sort of newscaster here, I'm not accustomed to this at all. Interactive bit, you know. Right, okay, so yes, the ideas were ours, and the ideas are mine, and I just happen to work with very good people that understand what I do, and they kind of interpret them for me and help me to realize them, in actual fact. This is the way I've worked with everything. Mm-hmm.
I've actually got one of the faxes wanted to talk about videos, too. This is from Jason Fawcett of Mississauga. In your videos, you seem to have a fascination with Victorian-era genre. Is this your favorite time period?
No. I'll rob, beg, and steal from anything, you know, as long as it's relevant to the song. I use that because it was a particular sort of parody on very the old notion of sentimental love, and I think that we're still harking back to that. I think we haven't really quite outgrown it yet, and I think we really need to modify or change the way that we behave to each other. So, I mean, as somebody living in Britain, you're constantly reminded of this sort of old empirical thinking, and anyway, I could talk and spiel and spiel. I'll meet you in the restaurant later, and we can do that. We can interact a little bit.
Well, continuing on a theme of sorts here, this is Jason Lennon. He wants to know, will you be featuring some gay couples in the future videos, or talk about homophobia in your song?
I don't care if you're gay or you're straight. You can come, you can be on my videos, you know. It makes absolutely no difference to me. You know, your sexual orientation is your own affair. You know, I don't.
There you go.
Come out if you want to come out. Stay in if you want to stay put. You know, that's my philosophy.
Live and let live, I think we could all do with that. There's a phone caller, Joanne from Edmonton. Hi, Joanne.
Hi.
Have you got a question for Annie?
Yes, I do, actually. I'd like to know, what is your favorite song to perform and why?
Well, I like Chill. I have to say that Chill, You Have Placed a Chill in My Heart, is wonderful to perform, you know, because it has all of the extremes of emotion, and it has the fragility, and there's a place where you can kick in. But I mean, you know, essentially, give me a song and I'll sing it. You know, I'm anybody's. I'm cheap.
Well, you're wonderful too.
That's not true. That was a lie. I'm very expensive.
We're pretty well coming to the end of our show right now, so, if you want to sing, here it is. This is a song. It's a Neil Young cover. Oh, I'm sorry, they're talking in my ear. Talking about interactive voices in your head. They want me to go to a speaker's corner right now. Any monitor, and here's a speaker's corner.
Here it comes. Listen carefully.
Hi, Annie. My name is Charlene. I'm from Springdale, Newfoundland. I was wondering if you were going to tour your next album, and if so, are you planning to come to Newfoundland? It's a great spot, and I know you'd love it.
Thank you.
And that's it. Please come to Newfoundland.
Right.
You probably won't end up in Springdale because it's a bit too small, but probably Cornerbrook or St. John's.
Well, bless you. You're a very sweet girl. I mean, happy to come, you know. Well, I don't have any plans, you know, for touring or anything. Hey, but hey, you never know. I might change my mind tomorrow.
There you go. Well, we'll leave that option open, okay? Okay, time for one last call. Where are you calling from, caller?
It's Dwayne.
It's Dwayne. Hi, Dwayne. Sorry, I didn't know your name.
I'm calling from Sudbury.
From Sudbury. And your question?
Yeah. Okay, it's more a compliment to you, Annie. I guess I've been a fan of yours since the Eurythmics basically started. I saw Eurythmics in 1989. I loved it. I just wanted to say that your music, to me, is a great inspiration. I'm a songwriter myself. I guess, how do I explain this? I'm very nervous. I'm sorry. Okay, when you released Diva, a good example, okay? I noticed you're very deep and emotional and passionate when you sing and when you write. And I find I relate to you, and I'd like to basically say that that album itself helped me get through a very hard time. And I just basically wanted to tell you that I appreciate your music because it touches me, and I feel that I relate to it a lot. So just basically wanted to say I love you and keep making great music. And I'll be your fan till the end.
Oh, bless you, bless you.
Thank
bless you.
You,
you're dear.
I love you.
You're dear, dear, dear. Dear person. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Well, I think that's a perfect lead into our final song. This is a cover tune of a Neil Young song, a guy who's making music to the end, and we'd endorse him every single time, and we hope you'll be making music for the rest, forever and ever and ever. Here she is, Annie Lennox. Don't Let It Bring You Down.
And the morning paper.
Chum City Production.
Intimate and Interactive is brought to you by Toyota.